Hello friends, my name is SSN Murthy. I'm ex-Deputy General Manager, Union Bank of India. I was overseeing risk management and treasury department of my bank. Now I've been asked to talk on money market instruments, and the basic things and basic subjects are already covered. So I'm going to cover only the updations, what are required and what is important in money market instruments. To start with money market, you know, money market starts from one day to it's up to 1 year. One day products are repo, call money, and up to 1 year your 364 treasury bills are there. And money markets, if you see some of the salient features, they are closed substitutes for money and can be called as money equivalent or money substitutes. And why banks park money in a money market instrument, that it can be quickly converted into money with minimum cost. The transaction cost should be very minimum. The conversion cost should not be very high. And one more thing, the major feature of money market instrument is that they are discounted instruments. What is the meaning of discounted instruments? They are P minus I instruments. It means as of today, I invest 98 rupees 40 paisa, and on due date I'll be getting 100. The difference between today's price and the maturity is 1 rupee 60 paisa. If you see the PowerPoint, that takes care of the interest factor. It means I'm investing P minus I, that is principal minus interest, today. On due date I'm going to get principal, whereas your regular other features are you are investing P and on due date you will get P plus I, and this is called discounted instruments. That's why money market instruments are also called as a deep discount instruments. Normally banks will be, those who are investing in money market, they will be getting normally negative rate of returns when compared to the deposit, average deposit rates, because probably banks are investing in money market in order to boost their liquidity, because they've got a lot of commitments, probably like premature closure of deposits and all that. To meet that commitments, banks park their funds in money market, and sometimes advance pickup may not be there at that time they are parking in money market instruments. Now, having discussed the features of money market instruments, latest many updations have come in, particularly in treasury bills and commercial papers, RBI guidelines, which I would like to discuss. Particularly treasury bills, as you are aware, treasury bills are available for 91 days, 182 days and 364 days. And beyond this, they are called debtor securities, and government borrows from money from and the market, and the government debtor bonds are ranging from 2 years to 30 years. The government always tries to enhance the tenor or duration of the bonds. And treasury bills, particularly, they are all called zero coupon bonds, and against a money market instrument, they are discounted instruments. As I told, whoever invests today, they'll be investing P minus I. On due date, they'll be getting their principals or maturity, which is normally around some. Probably if you say 98 rupees 20 is the price you are investing today, on due date you will be getting 100. The difference being 100 minus 98 20, it is called 1 rupee 80 paisa is the interest which the RBI would be paying for those who are investing. So to go back to the PPT, the return to the investor is the difference between the maturity value or face value, that is 100, and the issue price, which it, here it is taken as 98 rupees 20 paisa. Now, one more feature of treasury bills are called cash management bills, and this is government of India is introduced in 2010, because government, like anybody, any other thing, they have got also liquidity to meet their emergent situation or commitments. They normally government asks the RBI to issue cash management bills. Cash management bills, the features are mainly they are T bills, but they are issued for maturities less than 90 days. So cash management bills are short-term bills issued by central government to meet its immediate cash needs. Again, RBI only manages this. RBI is acting as bankers to RBI, and all cash management bills are issued by RBI. Hence, CMBs are short-term money market instruments that help government to meet its temporary cash flow mismatches. If you go to your corporate finance, this is can be called equally called this cash management are called as quick assets, because they are less than 90 days, and when it is they are issued, they are called quick asset, and when it is paid, they are called quick liabilities. Only to meet their emergent situation of the government, RBI is issuing come out with cash management bills. Otherwise, the features are on par with T-bills. They are also discounted instruments. And again, if you see, go to the PPT, CMBs have maturity less than 90 days. CMBs have generic character of treasury bills. And for example, same thing I told, the CMB is issued for 60 days. Probably at the time, at the date of issue, it is 97 rupees. On due date, you will be getting 100. The tenure or maturity notified amount, all these things RBI comes out with their notification, and banks, they are supposed to see all these things. And as told already, CMBs are issued for to match the government's temporary cash requirements. And one more feature of CMB is that just like any treasury bill or debtor bills, they are also getting a status of SLR securities. It means banks investing in that, they get that it will be treated under the 19.5%, which is the SLR percent requirement, and this will add up to that. So, and again, if you see what is the difference between CMB and treasury bills are, treasury bills mainly 91, 182, 364, but here they are issued for period less than 90 days. It can be 10 days, 15 days, on any period less than 90 days. That's the main difference between cash management bills and treasury bills. Now again, coming back to this, your trade T-bill auction. Auction can be of two types. One can be yield-based auction, another can be price-based auction. And here, if you see, RBI is issuing the securities on behalf of RBI. Yield-based auction, RBI tried to give lesser yield to the market participants. When it coming to price-based auction, it tries to recover more price from the participants. Now, in case of yield-based auction, if you look at the PPT, a yield-based auction is generally conducted when new G-Secs are issued. Investor bid in yield at terms up to 2 decimals, not 3, 4 decimals are not permitted, like that 8.19, 8.20, 8.14, like that. Bids are arranged in ascending order, and cutoff yield is arrived at the yield corresponding to notified amount of the auction. Suppose RBI has come out with 200 crore, all the yields are kept, arranged in ascending order. Where it matches 200, that is the cutoff yield. The cutoff yield is then fixed as the coupon rate for the security. Successful bidders are those who have bid at or below the cutoff yield. Bids which are higher than the cutoff yields are normally rejected. The logic here is that RBI will give less yield to the investor. As told, I've told you, in case of giving yield, they'll give less yield. In case of recovering price, they'll be recovering more price. Again, I come back to price-based auction. Normally, price-based auctions are issued by the government, and when they reissue the securities. A price-based auction is conducted when Government of India reissues securities which have already been issued earlier. Bid quotes here, it is when yield-based, here the procedure followed is contra. Bidders quote in terms of price per 100 of face value of the security, that is 102, 101, or 99, like that it is quoted. Bids are arranged in descending order. In yield-based, we have seen it is ascending order. Here it is descending order, and the successful bidders are those who bid at or above the cutoff price. Bids which are below the cutoff price are rejected. The logic here, as I told already, RBI will try to recover maximum price from the investors. Then again, if you come to that, like yield-based auction, price-based auction, again, the bidding can be competitive bidding and it can be non-competitive bidding. And the banks are mostly, they come under competitive bidding, and non-competitive bid is kept for only retail players. In a competitive bidding, an investor bid at a specific price or yield, and it's allotted security, the price or yield quoted within the cutoff price or yield. Competitive bids are made by well-informed institutional investors such as banks, financial institutions, primary dealers, mutual funds, and insurance companies. Now, if you see, normally the minimum bid amount is 10,000, multiples of 10,000, it means 10,000, 20,000, like that it has to go in debtor securities. And particularly for T-bills, the minimum is 25,000 and it is multiples of 25,000, it means 50,000, 75,000, 1 lakh it will be going. Multiple bidding, so your bank can apply for 2, 3 times, that it's not a question, they can apply, that's permitted. Multiple bidding is also allowed, that is, investor may put multiple bids at various prices and yield level. Again, as we told, non-competitive bid, it is kept for only retail investors. This scheme was announced by RBI in the year January 2002, because government borrowing program is very heavy. They borrow only about 6 lakh crores per year for carrying out their welfare programs. So the shortfall they are looking from even retail participants. NCP is normally open to individuals, HUFs, RRBs, cooperatives, firms, companies, corporate bodies, institution, provident fund trusts, they are called retail. Under the scheme, eligible investors apply for certain amount of securities in an auction without mentioning the price or yield. Here in this, the cutoff price will be the average of the cutoff price, average of what it is. That's why even though they need not mention the price or yield. Such bidders are allotted security as weighted average, that's what, or weighted average price or weighted average yield of the auction. The participants in non-competitive bids are however required to hold a gilt account with a bank. It means when banks are holding SGL account, these retailers, they should be owning the CSGL account. So however required to hold a gilt account with a bank or PD. RRBs and cooperatives which hold SGL and current account with RBI can also participate under the scheme. And normally the amount allowed under this is, the amount reserved for NCB is 5% notified amount in case of Government of India debt security, that is securities issued beyond 1 year, and 10% for notified in case of state development loans, and 20% of the amount in case of inflation index bond. Nowadays, RBI is not coming out with this inflation bond very frequently. Banks and PDs are required to consolidate the individual requirements of their clients and allowed to submit only a single bid under non-competitive bidding scheme. Again, continue with the NCB, in every auction of GOI debt securities, a maximum 5% of the notified amount is reserved for such non-competitive bids. This 5% is outside the cutoff, whatever the amount that has been kept by RBI. Suppose RBI says 300 crores is kept for, this 5% is outside this, 5% of 300 is outside the 300 crores. In case of auction for treasury bills, the amount accepted for non-competitive bids is over and above, that's what I told, the notified amount, and there is no limit placed. So this non-competitive limit is restricted to 5% of the amount fixed by RBI, and it is outside the limit. However, non-competitive treasury bills is available only to state government eligible provident funds, select foreign central banks, and is not available to the cooperative banks for proprietary bids. Only one bid is allowed, whereas in non-competitive multiple bids are allowed. Only one bid is allowed to be submitted by an investor either through a bank or through primary dealers. For bidding under the scheme, an investor has to fill in an undertaking and send it to the application for allotment of security to the bank or primary dealers through whom they are going to apply. The minimum amount and the maximum amount is, minimum one investor can apply is 10,000 rupees and maximum is 2 crore respectively in case of auction of debtor securities. Continuing with your NCB scheme, a bank or primary dealer can charge, because they are doing a service, they are eligible for a commission of 6 paisa per 100 for application money that can be collected from the investors as commission for rendering the services. In case the total application received for non-competitive bids exceeds 5% of the notified amount of the action for debtor securities, again like competitive bidding here also, they will be allotted on pro rata basis. NCB scheme has been introduced in, originally it was allowed in T-bills and government securities. From 2009, government has extended to state development bonds also. This has been from August 2009. The aggregate amount reserved for the purpose, for this purpose and under SDL is also 10%, whereas in case of T-bills and other, it is 5%. In this case, 10% of notified amount. If it is 1,000 crore is the amount allowed by RBI, 100 crore will be under NCB route, subject to a maximum of 1% of notified. A single bidder cannot apply for more than 1% of the amount. The bidding and allotment procedure is similar to G6, same way. And now we'll go to calculation of T-bill is given in the next slide, how we are going to calculate. This is a big formula and it is taken from RBI site, and I have simplified it in the next slide. Now, for example, to put it simply, I am investing 98 rupees 20 paisa today for a 91 days treasury bill on due date, I'm going to get 100 rupees. So the formula will be, I'm investing 98.20 today for 91 days, and the interest amount I'll be getting will be 1 rupee 80 paisa. If the amount invested is 100 for 365, why 100? I'm coming to an annualized yield for 100 rupees. What will be the yield? So this is the formula, 100 into 365 into 180 divided by this, and you'll be getting 7.3521. The same thing is also there in the RBI slide. You can see 7.3521, which I have put it very simply here. Now let us see what are the main features of T-bill. T-bills are varying maturities with the maximum tenor of 364 days will be sold. I already told you 91 days, 182 days and 360. We have to just double it, 91, 182, 364 on auction. The date and place of auction and the exact tenor of bills will be announced by RBA from to time. Normally, 91 days treasury bills are available on every Friday, and 91 on reporting Wednesdays. Now the RBI announces 91 days and 364 days. On non-reporting Wednesdays, the government RBI announces 91 plus 182 days treasury bill. It means every Wednesday you'll be getting 91 days treasury bill. On reporting Wednesday, you'll be getting 91 days plus 364 days treasury bill. On non-reporting Wednesdays, you'll be getting 91 days plus 182 days treasury bill. Now, it means there will be an auction of treasury bills every Wednesday. RBI will notify the nominal amount of bills to be sold to competitive bidders from time to time. Nowadays, they can go their software. And RBI may make allocations at the auctions by means of either uniform price auction. I already told it can be multiple price auction. The method of auction will be announced by the bank. By bank means it is RBI from time to time. The bills will be issued at discounted price because this is also a money market instrument. One of the features of money market is they are discounted instruments. Again, in respect of competitive bids, the rate of discount and the corresponding issue price would be determined at each auction. In case of uniform price action, competitive bids will be accepted at the minimum discounted price called the cutoff price determined at the auction irrespective of the bid prices tendered. In case of multiple price, in case of uniform price, those who are given allotted, they'll be paying same price for the entire issue. But in case of multiple price, at the cutoff price, it will be closed, but all those will be given different price at which they are allotted. In case of multiple price auction, competitive bills will be accepted up to minimum discounted price called cutoff price, determine the auction at bid price tendered at the auction. Competitive bids at offer prices lower than the cutoff bill will be rejected in case of both uniform and multiple price auction. So rejection beyond cutoff, both in case of uniform price, multiple, it will be rejected. Allocation of non-competitive will be, we already discussed, again, will be at the discretion of RBI. These non-competitive bids will be outside the notified amount. As I told, the 5% of T-bill is outside the our allotment amount. Such allocation for non-competitive bids will be at the weighted average price arrived at on the base of competitive bids accepted at the auction. I got a slide to support this. We'll see this. RBI will have the full discretion to accept or reject any or all the bids, either wholly or partially, as deemed fit by it without assigning any reason. RBI may, if it considers appropriate to do so, or participate in the auction as a non-competitor and buy bills for the part or whole of the amount notified at the cutoff price decided in the auction. The investment in treasury bills through competitive route may be made by any person resident in India, including firms, companies, corporates, institutions, and trusts. Non-residents, particularly, we'll see what are the rules applicable to non-resident. Non-resident Indian foreign investors are eligible to invest subject to approval of government provisions of FEMA Act. This only guides and regulation framed there under, in addition to other provisions of law applicable to government securities. I have discussed already. Again, I'm discussing on non-competitive a little elaborately. Eligible entities could participate on non-competitive basis in auction for specified bills as decided by RBI from time to time. The state government, eligible provident funds in India, the Nepal Rashtra Bank, of government, they are also eligible. And persons or institutions, specifically RBI, with the approval of government in this regard, can participate on non-competitive basis. Individual can also participate on non-competitive basis as retail investors. For retail investors, the allocation will be restricted to maximum 5% of aggregate nominal amount of the issue. It means total size is 1,000 crore. It means 5% will come to 50 crores within the notified amount as specified Government of India or any other percentage determined RBI. Explanation. The allocation for individual shall be within the notified amount, and for our other eligible entities outside the amount. It means the individuals will come within the limit, and those other eligible means they can be state government, like I told, RRBs, cooperatives, they can be outside the notified amount. Eligible provident funds are those non-government provident funds, governed by provident fund, which means those who are provident fund entity, they can apply. They should qualify under PF Act of 1925 or Employees Provident Fund Provisions Act of 1952. They are only eligible to apply under NCB route. Now again, I'm going to explain how this uniform price and multiple price action is done. Now you can see the bidders are A, B, C, D, E, and F, and RBI today wants to allot 300 crores under competitive bidding process. And this is a price-based auction. You can see A is quoted for 90 crore at 98.50, and B has quoted 98.40. It is 60 crore it has applied, the cumulative comes to 150 crores. C has applied for 98.35 and they applied for 80 crores and the cumulative comes to 230, and D has applied for 98.30 and they applied for 70 crores. And this 300 crores, this is the limit fixed by RBI, it has crossed here. It means this participant E and F will not be allotted. And again, suppose at 98.30, two people have applied, then it will be given to them. Let us assume now, as you go back, if you see the slide, the cutoff price at 300 closes 98.30. So this is called cutoff price. Let us assume that the cutoff price fixed in the auction is 98.30. Bids up to the cutoff price, that is A, B, C, and D, will be accepted, and E and F will be rejected. You can see A, B, C, D will be accepted, and E and F will be rejected. In case of uniform price auction, now again go back to that, there are two auctions are there, uniform price and multiple price. If it is uniform price auction and everybody will be charged, there they'll be issued T-bill at a cutoff price of 98.30 rupees. But in case of multiple auction, everybody will be issued at different price. For A, it will be 98.50, for B, it will be 98.40, for C, it will be 98.35, and D, it will be 98.30. It means the weighted average price in case of uniform will be 98.30, whereas weighted average for others, you will have to multiply and arrive at the fresh weighted average. So in case of uniform price auction, each successful bidder will have to pay 98.30 irrespective of the bid they applied. For example, if you go back, A has applied at 98.50, in uniform, he will also be charged 98.30 only. But in case of multiple, he will be charged 98.50. Okay. Whereas in case of multiple price auction, each successful bidder will have to pay the price he had offered. The total amount payable will be for them, if it is multiple, 98.50 divided by 100 into 90, this is what they applied, and the total, if you can, it comes to 295.18 crores, whereas in uniform price it comes to 294.90. It means RBI will be recovering more price in case of multiple, whereas they'll be recovering less. In the minimum treasury bill that can be issued is 100, which I already told, and multiples of 100, and all treasury bills are promissory notes, and it is the promissory note will be signed by RBI, and the format is also specified by RBI, and everybody should have SGL account, because whenever treasury bills are issued, the bank's current account will be debited and the SGL account will be credited. Now the bills will be transferable in terms of government of security. They can be transferable almost like negotiable instruments. The repayment will be on due date. The bill will be repaid at par on expiration of their tenor at the office of the bank at which they are registered. In case of non-competitive, I already told. Now RBI has come out with November 2017, this non-competitive bidding through exchanges. We have got BSE, NSE exchanges. And now in the previous NCB, it was allotted only on OTC basis, whereas here it is going to be allotted on exchanges. It means exchanges are also going to handle the non-retail investor through non-competitive bids. This circular has come in November 2017 as a part of the overall strategy of diversifying the investor. The government of India and RBI have been taking various measures to encourage the participation of retail investors in government's security market, including introduction of non-competitive bid. Because government is borrowing very heavy amount, they are looking for all the source to borrow. It can be through OTC or it can be through exchanges. That's why they come out with this new scheme from November 2017. In continuing of this endeavor, the Union Budget has announced inter alia that RBI will facilitate retail participation in the primary market through stock exchanges. So like your equity are quoted, the treasury bills will also be quoted in exchanges, and exchanges will be handling, and they will be serving only the retail customers. In line with this, now based on this budget announcement, RBI has again come out with the circular, and it has decided that in addition to scheduled banks, primary dealers, specified stock exchanges will be permitted to act as aggregators or facilitators. It means NSE, BSE, they can also act as aggregator and facilitators. These stock exchanges will submit a single consolidated non-competitive bid in the auction process and will put in place necessary process to transfer the securities so allotted in primary auction to their members or clients. Stock exchange desirous of acting as aggregators can, who will approve this? CGM, IDMD is the authority. To the stock exchange will have to apply to this RBI CGM, and they will be approving. Once they are approved, then they can start aggregating the T-bills in turn from the retail participants. Eligibility. Participation on non-competitive basis in the auction will open to retail investors who do, one, what are the qualities, what are the character, what are the features, one, does not maintain current account or subsidiary general account with the Reserve Bank of India, submits bid indirectly through an aggregator. It means they should come through, they should not go through directly, they should go through an exchange. Quantum allocation of non-competitive bids from retail investors will be restricted to a maximum 5% of the aggregate nominal amount of the issue within the notified amount. It means in case of previous NCB, it was this 5% is outside the notified amount, and in this case it is within the notified amount as specified by the Government of India or any other percentage determined by RBI. Presently it is now at 5%. As similar to non-competitive year also, the minimum amount of bidding will be 10,000, multiples of 10,000. In the auction, GO security retail investors can make a single bid for an amount not more than rupees 2 crore. There also it was 10 and 2 crore. Here also the same thing is kept. Other guidelines are the retail investor desires to participate in the auction under the scheme would be required to maintain depository account with any of the deposit, NSDL, CSDL, they have to maintain, because there anybody applying under the route, their SBR current account will be debited, their NSDL, CSGL account will be credited for holding of the government securities. Under the scheme, an investor can make only a single bid in an auction, and undertaking to the effect that the investor is making only a single bid will have to be obtained and kept on record by the aggregator or facilitator. And this is on what is your non-competitive bid. And I will now pass on to RBI circular of August 2017 on commercial paper. The commercial paper circular is thoroughly revamped, and commercial paper is also a money market instrument. Commercial paper definition is an unsecured money market instrument issued in the form of promissory note. The original tenor of CP shall be between 7 days and 1 year. And for financial institution, they can issue more than 1 year up to 3 years. And the idea behind is that from 7 days to 1 year, commercial banks will participate. Beyond 1 year to 3 year, the financial institution will participate. So both of them will not compete. The domains are different. They will not competing each other. The remaining changes are the main changes are the net worth criteria has been removed. Companies including NBFCs, All India Financial Institution, all eligible to issue CP subject to condition that any funded facility availed from banks or financial is classified as standard asset by financial institutions at the time of issue. Other entity cooperatives have a government securities, limited liabilities, any other having presence of net worth can also of 100 crore can also issue. All residents or non-residents permitted to invest in CP are subject to FEMA rules. Investment by regulated financial entities will be subject to such conditions as governed by RBI from time to time. And the CP, again, minimum is 5 lakhs and multiples of 5 lakhs. And no issuer shall have the issue of CP underwritten. Call option, put option not permitted. They are also discounted. They are also discounted instruments. And any CP shall be issued in the form of promissory note and held in a dematerialized form. Through it is it cannot be maintained physical form. It has to maintain only dematerialized form. And the main thing is that the rating fixed in the new circular is A3. The minimum credit rating for CP shall be A3 as per rating symbol and definition prescribed by SEBI. And eligible issues whose total CP issues during the calendar is 1,000 or crore. This is a new direction RBI has given. Any corporate going for 1,000 crores or more, they should get their external rating done by two raters. It means this is a new thing. And shall obtain credit rating for issuance of CP from at least two permitted, CRISIL, ICRA, or there are 6-7 RBI accredited agencies. When their limit goes beyond 1,000 crore per year, calendar year, then they should obtain two ratings. And between the two ratings, the lesser ratings will be taken. A CP should be a standalone product because it's standalone. And in case sometimes if it is not possible, the A3 rating is not coming, or they are A4, A5 like that, then banks can go for, based on the request of the corporate, they can go for a standby assistance credit or backstop facility. This is permitted. And other than this, non-banking entities, probably the flagship companies can give an unconditional irrevocable guarantee to the subsidiaries, or any third party can give. If that be the case, now the what RBI circular says that any, this is called credit enhancement, and they should say CP should provide the offer document for CP properly disclose the net worth of the guarantor, because the public should know what is the net worth of the guarantor, names of the companies to which the guarantor has, suppose he has issued 2-3 guarantees already, that limit should also be given. And whatever the trade that takes place in CP, it should be reported. All OTC trades should be reported within 15 minutes of the trade to Financial Market Trading Reporting and Confirmation Product, FTRAC, of this is what Clearing Corporation maintains. It should be mentioned. So that the settlement cycle for CP, normally OTC is, it can be T plus 0 or T plus 1. Suppose trades takes place in the evening, it can be T plus 1. In the morning, it can be T plus 0. OTC trades in a CP shall be settled through clearing bank of any recognized stock exchanges or any other mechanism approved by RBI. Now, buyback provision, the buyback of CP in full or part shall be at the prevailing market price. The buyback offer should be extended to all investors in the CP issue. The term of the buyback should be identical for all investors in the issue. The buyback offer may not be made before 30 days. Or in the origin, previously it was 7 days. Now this buyback period is extended up to 30 days. CP can be bought back as, once it is bought back, the CP liability gets extinguished. And there is a thing called IPA, issuing and paying agent. The corporate with whom they are banking, they are going to issue the CP, they are called issuing, the same bank will be paying it. That's why they are called IPA. There are a lot of responsibilities attached to IPA because they are the one, they fix the limits, they are the one, they come out with prospectus and all that. That's why IPA, they are going to issue, and on due date they'll be paying it. And the latest in money market is that on June 6th, RBI has hiked the repo rate from 6% to 6.25. And based on this, the corridor is kept at 25 basis point and reverse repo stands at 6% and bank rate now says stand, both bank rate and marginal standing bill stand at 6.50. This is what the change that has taken place based on six member. Now RBI revises all these policy rates based on the Monetary Policy Committee. It consists of six members, three members from RBI and three from the government. They unanimously decided to hike the repo rate to 6.25.